I'm the Olympic and Universiad champion in artistic gymnastics, and I'd like to welcome you to Campus Sport and the upcoming Universiad in Gwangju. Yang Hak-seon was born in Gwangju, and he'll take part in the vault as defending champion at the 2015 Universiad. The 23-year-old has a special message for all the student athletes coming to South Korea for the competition. I think the Universiad of Gwangju is going to be very attractive, and there are so many aspects to discover in the city that I'd like the athletes to see, not only focusing on the competitions, but also taking their time to visit and explore my city of Gwangju. But we start Campus Sport with the inspirational story of Thomas van der Platzen. Then we'll put the spotlight on Yang Hak-seon, plus Sergey Lebed and Sandor Taric, all University Games champions. And finally, a portrait of the IOC vice president and former Universiad champion, Nawal Al-Mutawakkil. Some 12,000 athletes from 170 countries are in South Korea, ready for the Gwangju Summer Universiad, taking place from July the 3rd to the 14th. There are 69 competition and training venues for 21 different sports. The Games director is Mark van den Plas.
We are expecting this will be a big Universiad game, not as big as the one in Kazan in Shenzhen, because there were more sports, but that normally should be really very successful Universiad. And I want just to remind you that Universiad still remains the second biggest multi-sports games in the world. So it will be a very, very big event.
Gwangju is the third city in South Korea to host a Universiad, and its byword is EPIC, an acronym E for ecology, P for peace, I for information technology, and C for cultural values. All ideals to contribute to mankind's development through sport. Deinze in Belgium. Thomas van der Platzen is back on the track training for the World University Games. After several months of absence from the international scene, the decathlete is enjoying the most important victory of his life. The Universiad winner of Kazan has defeated the cancer that was detected last September.
I feel good knowing where I'm coming from, but I can't say I'm completely like the old Thomas Decathlon athlete yet, but I'm getting closer and closer every week, so I'm glad to be on the track, like going for a goal, but I'm realistic in saying that I'm not completely in top shape yet. Gwangju was, I think, perfect timing. It was a challenge because it was not a lot of time to get ready, but it was also something I was looking forward to defend my title. Last straight line, so I mean, this is I leave in 2 weeks, so we're just trying to get my body competition ready and ready for a full decathlon, so which is going to be very hard. So we're trying to just up the intensity in training and make sure that I recover from day to day.
The Athletics Cup of Deinze gives Thomas the best conditions to work on his recovery. Coached by his brother Michael, a former decathlete himself, Thomas is working hard, preparing for the upcoming Summer Universiad. Two daily training sessions are programmed, and Thomas is progressing despite some ups and downs.
He wants to come back better than he was before. I think he has a lot of potential. But we take it step by step. It's very hard to predict where we're going to be in the next 6 months.
At the beginning of the year, Thomas went to South Africa to build his body up again. It's his favorite country. He's trained there for several years. Mentally, he rediscovered himself too, supported by his brother and local training partners.
We started in January, quite quickly after the chemotherapy. And in the beginning, the physical part was really hard. So running, I remember he would do like a jog 400 meters around the track, and that was it. It was finished.
As soon as he started doing a bit more high intensity training, he started having some low days, and I could see mentally he started just dropping down. And you've just got to be there for him, you know. You've just got to say, listen, this is normal. You had a serious illness. I mean, it's expected with this type of training, but your body will adjust. You will get over it.
Because I wanted to move forward, and I obviously had this picture in mind of preparing for the university games and going forward every week, but it felt like for 2 months I wasn't going anywhere. I think the last few weeks I'm starting to really put that behind me, and now training is becoming something more enjoyable again.
Thomas's world had fallen apart on the 3rd of September last year. He underwent an anti-doping test at home. At the time, he was preparing his ambitious Road to Rio program. 3 weeks later, he got the results of the test.
I came home after training and I saw a letter on the table stating that I had tested positive for HCG, which was, which blindsided me completely because I had no clue where it came from. So obviously that was a very big shock to me, and it set in motion a series of events that changed my life completely.
Thomas simply couldn't understand how HCG, a hormone associated with pregnancy, could be in his body. He protested his innocence, insisting that he'd never taken any doping substances.
So we immediately knew there was another problem. And so we researched the internet, and we were trying to find more information on the hormone that Thomas tested positive on, and we concluded fairly quickly that it probably was cancer, because we knew he didn't take any drugs, so the only other option was cancer. So we called up his doctor, and the next day we found out he had cancer.
But in the meantime, the media were headlining his positive test, ignoring the fact that 24 hours later, he learned that he had testicular cancer. HCG can be excreted by some tumors, including testicular cancers.
Thomas had never tested positive before. He had no abnormal values. And I think he should have gotten the benefit of the doubt.
That's something that, as an athlete, you never want to have happen to you in your life. I was lucky in the sense that I knew that my name was going to get cleared quite fast because of the medical condition. But yeah, it's very hard to just get everything you've built up over the years. Like, I mean, I have an honest reputation. I've always been open with everyone, and I've always been a very hardworking athlete. And just to have that reputation and that whole image of yourself, just see it slashed to the ground by one single article about doping is something that you cannot imagine as an athlete.
At the European Championships, Thomas had finished 10th in the decathlon, winning the high jump discipline along the way. Now he was facing surgery and heavy chemotherapy, fighting the hardest battle of his life.
He was one of the best athletes in the world. And then just a few months later on, he's losing all his body weight, he's losing his hair, he's feeling sick, he's throwing up, and it's been pretty tough on him.
2014 had been a good year for Thomas van der Platsen. He'd won bronze at the World Cup indoor event at Sopot in Poland. In doing so, he set a new Belgian record. Now, he refused to let the cancer get him down.
It's very hard to cope with at first, but I think I took peace with it quite quickly and realized that I just had to put my energy into coming back and into getting healthy again. And then I'm sure I'll get back to that level and then be able to dream again of winning medals.
A year earlier, back in July 2013, the Summer Universiade in Kazan, Thomas van der Platsen took the gold medal in the decathlon. He'd been struggling with a serious injury. Now, he was back at the top.
It wasn't an easy competition. The circumstances weren't ideal. So I was very glad to pull through and actually get that win after having struggled for over a year with injuries.
Thomas chose the decathlon because he loves challenges. At Ostrava in 2011, he won the under-23 European Championships, demonstrating his talent in the competition over a period of 2 days.
I just love the stress and I love the tension and the motivation it gives me to perform. And like, I mean, it's an environment I thrive in. And I think that's something that has set me apart in the past and that'll hopefully keep serving me in the future.
Thomas knows how to adapt to the humid heat of Guangzhou in the summertime, and he's preparing to defend his title down to the finest detail. His personal best is 8,255 points, and he's hoping to get close to that figure again in the University Games.
I would love to score over 8,000 points in the decathlon. That's kind of an ambitious goal to say 6 months after getting cancer treatment to say, like, I want to get 8,000 again, but it's something that motivates me.
Thomas van der Platsen sets an example for everybody, showing that there is hope, showing a fighting spirit. And he's ready for Guangzhou, not as a cancer patient, but as an athlete once more. Coming up on Campus Sport, the fantastic vaulter, Yang Haxun. And three other Universiade champions with a story worth telling.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values. Excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
His name is Yang Haxun. He's age 22. He's the Olympic and Universiade champion in the vault. And at the Korean National Training Center in Seoul, he's looking for peak performance for the upcoming World University Games. I really want to achieve my goal, a goal which consists of winning the gold medal in my discipline for the second time in a row. And after that, well, I hope that all the other Korean athletes taking part can also perform very well during the games. Yang Haxun was born in a Gwangju shanty town. And now, while he's an athlete, he selflessly supports his family by sending them the modest stipend he receives from the Korean Gymnastics Association. Despite his poor childhood, he hasn't turned his back on his origins. I never felt shame about my family because they were poor or had no money. I started with gymnastics because, well, first of all, I love this sport. And secondly, for sure, the sport didn't demand a lot of important financial investment. So I've never had problems accepting the situation of poverty of my family. Yang is a student of the prestigious National Sport University in Seoul. He's always trained hard to be the best, and he became world champion in 2011 in Tokyo. My private situation of poverty had no impact on my performances or other fields of life. My parents continued to encourage me, but it wasn't like I have to get the gold medal because my family is poor. I was able to succeed because I practiced the exercises that were taught by my former coach. And then I felt and I knew that I could master those exercises. My former coach also told me that I could win a major international competition, and that was important. His efforts were rewarded once again at the London Olympics in 2012. He became the first Korean to win a gold medal in artistic gymnastics. His performance was enhanced by a three-twist front somersault invented by him. His dream had come true. A lot of people helped me afterwards. For example, the house that my parents are actually living in now is the house that was built by those generous people. I've also received a flat in the countryside as a gift. And with all those kinds of contributions, the lifestyle of my parents has improved a lot. So I was able to contribute to improve their life due to my results at the past Olympic Games. Yang also performed his most difficult vault 2 years ago at the Kazan University Games to take the gold there. And he'll endeavor to perfect it once more for his home Universiad this July. It's not a new vault. It's a technique I've already performed in London. It's the Yang One, also called the Yang Haxion. I've performed the vault at three international competitions, in fact. In Kazan, I got a great result with it. But the world champion of 2013 is also working on a new vault, named after him again as Yang Two. He hopes it'll astound the crowd and bring him gold again in Guangzhou. Guangzhou is my city, where I've always lived, so for sure I want to win a gold medal in front of the local crowd and especially my parents. They haven't seen me a lot because you don't have a lot of international competitions in South Korea. My parents came to see me for the first time at the Asian Games last year, but unfortunately, I couldn't get them the gold medal, and I regret that a lot. So, the Universiad in Guangzhou is a competition which really means a lot. It's also an occasion to finally offer my parents and my family that desired gold medal. So, to achieve it, I really am practicing and training very hard. Yang Haxion continues to write his story, a story of a man who leapt from obscurity to become an athletic hero. South Korea hosted their last summer Universiad in 2003 in Daegu, where a Ukrainian produced a very special performance in the 5,000 meters, Sergei Lebed. It was there he set a remarkable record, winning a third Universiad title in a row, only the fourth man to achieve it. Lebed is not a specialist of track and field, though. He prefers cross-country races. But in 1999, he won the 5,000 meters at the Summer Universiad in Palma de Mallorca in Spain. 13 minutes, 37.52 seconds, a new Universiad record. At the Beijing Summer Universiad in 2001, he returned to the track after finishing a disappointing seventh at the Sydney Olympics. He won in 13 minutes, 44.24 after a tremendous final lap. And then in the Daegu race of 2003, he won in 13 minutes 50.94 ahead of Germany's Jan Fitzen and Hichem Belani of Morocco. For the 28-year-old Ukrainian student, his third victory in a row gave him a special place in the history of university sport. The World University Games has a history stretching back decades. And one of the very early champions is now approaching his 102nd birthday. He's Sándor Tarić, a Hungarian. His golden years were the 1930s.
I played four. 1933 in Torino, Italy. and in 1935 when it's Paris, and in 1937 in Budapest, and 1939 in Vienna. On every one of those occasions.
Sport helped Sandor in his subsequent business career.
Being an athlete taught me that you can't win all the time. Mm-hmm. See, sometimes you lose. But that's also taught you that more you practice and better you can, there's a pattern developed, which was winning, losing, and later were winning, and losing. And winning, and losing. So you have learned that the road to success is paved with failures. That's the way I made it out. And in business, it's very important because you can't win every contract. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you lose it. That doesn't mean that you're defeated or something. Don't give it up. But it teaches us to keep on doing it, and it becomes better and better, and then it will at the end succeed.
His game was water polo. Not so much a sport, more a way of life.
Everything that I have learned as an athlete, that happened in my formative years when I grew up, and it became a habit with me that using my brain every situation and then trying to achieve what I wanted to accomplish. And then, for water polo, it was winning, and then in everyday life in business, it was providing for my family and myself and with the life.
Sandor Terić became an Olympic champion in 1936 and is the oldest living champion from the Games. Still to come on Campus Sport, the Moroccan woman who won gold at the World University Games and went on to become a truly inspirational figure in the Olympic movement too.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values. Excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Lausanne in Switzerland, a meeting of the Executive Commission of the International Olympic Committee. And one of its members, the first vice president, is Nawal El Moutawakel, the Moroccan student athlete who went on to become one of the world's most respected leaders in sport. University was fundamental. Without that academic passage, I would never be what I am today. Nawal rose to fame in 1984 at the Los Angeles Olympics in the 400 meters hurdles. She became the first African female Olympic champion. She'd been training at the University of Iowa in the USA because there was a lack of opportunity in her own country. I could win at any time in Morocco because I was alone really in the 400 meters hurdles, which was a new event for women at that time. We were, two, three, four athletes running the 400? And as I knew I was going to win, I just trotted to the finish line. But when I first arrived in the USA, there were thousands of women who ran better than me or like me. And so you really had to be competitive. It was necessary to fight hard every time, to run until you were exhausted in order to snatch that first place. For Nawal, the United States presented a new language, a new culture, and a world of striving for excellence. It would form her character, a character put to the test almost as soon as she landed there. I lost my father a week after I arrived in the USA, that is. I learned about it several weeks later because they hid it from me. Because, precisely, they didn't want me to become depressed, that the dream of becoming an Olympic champion could have evaporated, so it was kept secret from me. A few weeks before the Games, Nawal had to make a choice, whether to quit or to push on in memory of her father.
I decided to stay here for 4 years or longer. I don't know. But if I did return back home, I would make a big mistake.
All this created an electric shock in my head, if you like, and I said, well, that's just the way it is. You know, sometimes we might give up, but often we can excel because everything is working to prepare yourself mentally, psychologically and physically to continue to move forward. Despite losing her father and adjusting to issues like the cold weather, Noelle knew that America offered a university course that could transform her life. I had to excel in athletics, of course, which is what I wanted, but it was also necessary for me to excel in academic studies in order to deserve the scholarship I got. So my effort was really a double one, because I not only had to first of all master English and then work by translating what I wanted in my head every time, but also to go ahead and to deserve to be in the track and field team. There was no internet, no tablets at that time, so we were always with a school bag full of working papers because the distances between different states are huge. So we were all the time leaning on our books, always had the lights on in the coaches with our highlighters because we knew, regardless of the time and the place you were in, the next examinations were set for a certain date, and you couldn't say to your professor, excuse us, we were in a competition. The challenge for Noelle was to continually reach the academic level required to stay at the university because, in terms of sports, certainly, she was outstanding, even becoming the captain of the Cyclones, the university athletics team, one of the best of them, in fact, in the United States. Often they call me Sirocco of Morocco because when I ran, I won everything, the 100, 200, 400, 4x100, all the events. And so they said, oh, no, not her, not the Moroccan again. They'd already lost, even before they started to compete. But there was a spirit of extraordinary solidarity. We spoke the same language. We had the same spirit, the same purpose, the same objective, which was to win the NCAA title every time. Noelle was crowned university champion in the United States several times. So it was natural that she take part in the Universiad, the World University Games. She took gold at Kobe in Japan in 1985, and 2 years later won her second title in Zagreb. For us, it was really like a party, a celebration, getting together as students and seeing how each and every one of us had evolved in the right direction, intellectually, at all levels. So for me, it was an unmissable event to every time represent my country first and somewhere my American university indirectly. And nowadays, you know, when I look back, when I look at the photos, I still think today how nice it was, what a good time it was. But Noelle would put an end to her athletics career following a terrible tragedy which shook the university, leaving her alone once again, a catastrophic plane crash. It was a real tragedy. I could have gone along as team captain, but I was not called that time. Somebody woke me up, I remember, one night in November, and I learned the bad news. There was a plane that had crashed, and the whole university team had been killed. Well, I said to myself, I'm going to quit. I was surrounded by people who were the most dear to me, my father, my coaches, the American team, and all those people had disappeared. 30 years on, the emotion is still there. But Noelle El-Moutawakil would see her life take a distinct turn for the better with the help of the president of FISU, Primo Nebbiolo. In the early 1990s, the Olympic Congress in Paris, which coincided with the introduction of a special quota for women in international institutions, gave me a little hope. And accompanied by Primo Nebbiolo and Lamine Diack and Samaranch, well, they brought me into this world that was totally new to me, a world I had to discover. Noelle became a figurehead for African women, a leader of a movement for the emancipation of women through sport. Somewhere, I felt a huge sense of pride to have taken part in pushing this door that was a little bit closed in the minds of some people, to understand that there are Muslim, Arab, African women who could also find their place at the international level. She became a member of the International Athletics Federation, the IAAF, in 1995, and then a member of the IOC in 1998, largely thanks to the time she'd spent at university. Education is important, and a university course is even more important. And I think that's the background. It's a formidable weapon that can help you forge your path and follow your career. Today's athletes, tomorrow's leaders. Nawal El Moutawakel is the perfect illustration of the slogan of FISU.
Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values, excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.